And welcome back to our Mystery Monday series on this channel. This video is probably coming out a little bit later to you, probably because I'm filming this a little bit later, but it's okay. We're still getting it out. That's all that matters. It's still Monday. Just a couple disclaimers before I actually deep dive into this case. This video is not meant to come off as rude to the victims, family of the victims, or anyone involved in this case. Everything I've compiled into this video is all public record and have been found from multiple online resources that I will link in the description box down below. This particular case involves the brutal sexual assault and murder of children. If that makes you uncomfortable, please exit out of this video and sit this one out. I'll be here next week with something a little less unnerving. And with all that being said, this is the case and unsolved murders of the Oklahoma Girl Scouts. Camp Scott was a magical place for girls of the Magic Empire created for Girl Scouts to camp in and enjoy the wonders of the outdoors. Camp Scott was located in Locust Grove, Oklahoma, and it had been a retreat for Girl Scouts and Brownies since 1928. Its 410 wooden acres could accommodate for 130 campers and 30 staff. So before we even get into the actual case, we have to go 2 months back before the actual day of the crime. 2 months before this crime took place, during a training session, a counselor's tent was ransacked, and oddly enough, the only thing taken from her tent was donuts. And in the box in their place was a note. In the handwritten note, the writer declared three campers would be murdered. Also, not long after that letter was discovered, a fake body was found hanging on the property. But all this was dismissed, and the note was trashed, as the counselors thought that it was some sort of prank. And then, unfortunately, on the night of June 13th, 1977, sometime between 2 and 4 a.m., three girls were pulled from their tent, beaten, strangled, sexually assaulted, and left on a trail. Two were buried in their sleeping bags, and another left partially clothed nearby. They were found some 150 yards away from their tent. Lori Lee Farmer, who was 8 years old, and Michelle Goosey, who was 9 years old, I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that right, but I'm assuming it's Goosey, were from Broken Arrow, Oklahoma. Ernest Denise Milner, who was 10, was from Tulsa. The day before the girls were found brutally murdered, all three loaded a bus in the Girl Scout headquarters in Tulsa. The campers traveled 40 miles east of Tulsa to Camp Scott to begin their 2-week stay in the wilderness. The campers were allowed to choose their tent buddies. The 14 by 12 foot tent bases were constructed of wood and covered in canvas and contained 4 mattress bunks. Each campsite was given a Native American tribe's name. Milner, Farmer, and Goosey were assigned to the Kiowa campsite. The trio of girls was actually supposed to be a quartet, but the fourth girl was misassigned to a different campsite. She was actually supposed to be moved in with the girls that evening, but due to a pending thunderstorm, the camp counselors decided to postpone the move. Kiowa tent number 8 was located on the edge of the campsite and was the farthest from the camp counselor's tent and couldn't even be seen from the counselor's tent at all, being that it was 150 yards away. Before and during 1977, Camp Scott had no lights in the wooden platforms other than the campers' flashlights. The only source of light were kerosene lanterns, which were lit and hung at night by the unit bathrooms. That night, the girls gathered in the dining tent before the storm. They chatted with their friends and enjoyed their dinner. After that, the girls went to their Kiowa campsite to retire for the night. The girls would then write their first and last letters to their families back home. According to Carla Wilhite, which was the camp counselor who found the three girls' bodies, she heard strange noises the night of the murders. Wilhite reported the sounds as being a cross between a bullhorn and a frog. It was low and guttural. It didn't sound like a language, it didn't sound like a human, and it didn't sound like an animal. Wilhite reportedly woke another counselor in her tent to ask if she had too heard the strange noises, but she didn't. Each time she heard the noises, she would flash her light and the noises would stop. She walked the tents, everything was quiet, so she went back to bed. But apparently, Minnie had actually heard those guttural noises that night. A girl in tent 6 claimed she was awoken by a figure standing in the entryway of her tent, shining a flashlight. She lay there, confused, as the figure scoped out the tent before zipping it back up and walking away. She was the only one who witnessed this, as she was the only one awake, so she went back to sleep, not thinking very much of it. At 3 a.m., a girl at the Cherokee campsite claims she heard a scream. She looked at her watch and woke up another girl from her tent. They listened for more noises, but upon hearing nothing, they both went back to sleep. Another girl from another campsite says she heard screams too, and someone crying for their mom. She was unsure of what to do, so she did nothing, and also went back to sleep. The night before the murders, two counselors had been frightened by two men at the campsite. Some campers claimed they saw a man in army boots behind their tent, while another man was seen by the bathrooms the night of the murders. Upon inspection of Tent 8, tape, rope, a gag, and a flashlight were collected from the victims and the scene. It was determined that Gousset and Farmer had been struck and killed in the tent, and that Milner had been taken into the woods and then killed. The killer had unsuccessfully tried to clean the blood off the wooden floor with mattress covers and towels. The bloody materials were then stuffed in the sleeping bags. A red flashlight was found on top of one of the girls' bodies, and on the lens of that flashlight was a thumbprint, but it had never been identified. And along with that fingerprint was a footprint. The footprint was size 9.5. All other campers were put on a bus that morning and sent back to Tulsa. None of them had any idea of what was going on or what had happened. Autopsy reports confirmed that the killer or killers' methods were absolutely horrific. Doris Milner had died of strangulation. There were also indications that she had been sexually assaulted. Michelle Gousset died from brutal beatings to her head. She had also been sexually assaulted and sodomized. Lori Farmer also had died from blows to the head. She too appeared to be sexually assaulted. Tape and cord marks were found on her body where the killer had removed the restraints that had been holding her. Investigators determined that Lori and Michelle were both bound with elastic bands in their sleeping bags. Both were in fetal positions and wrapped in bed sheets. Investigators believed that the two were killed seemingly while they were still sleeping inside their tent. However, investigators believed that Doris had been lured out of the tent, still alive, sexually assaulted, and beaten so badly that indentions from the weapon used to kill her remained as post-mortem artifacts on her body, although her cause of death is listed as strangulation. Crime scene materials were found in a cave not far from the camp and scene of the crime. Investigators found tape, plastic from a garbage bag that matched the plastic wrapped around the flashlight that was found next to the girls, two photos of women, eyeglasses, and a newspaper. The women in the photos that were found were identified after they appeared in several newspapers. A prison guard had taken the pictures at a wedding. Jean Leroy Hart had the pictures developed while he was serving time for kidnapping and first-degree rape convictions in 1966. Hart was paroled in 1969. Soon after, he was tried for 4 Tulsa burglaries and sentenced to 50 years of prison time. Hart was moved to Mays County Jail to appear for a post-conviction relief involving the rape and kidnapping charges imposed in 1966. But he escaped with another inmate, had been eluding law enforcement for a few years. Hart was diligently pursued in the murders of the 3 young girls after connecting him to the photos found in the cave. He was known to be in the Locust Grove area. His mother lived near Camp Scott. He was an outdoorsman and had previously been convicted of a brutal crime. So for the police, the search was on. It would take 10 months for police to locate Hart when he was apprehended from a home in the Crookston area. Even though most people thought it was clear that Hart was at fault for these crimes, there was actually a lot of people in the community who thought he was innocent. People raised money for his defense and supported him during his trial. There was actually little evidence to prove that Hart was the killer, though some people believed that he was, while others thought there were facts to prove that Hart wasn't the only killer. Many people believed there was no way Hart could have done this by himself. Hart had had a vasectomy years prior to the murder, so many people felt like the sperm evidence found at the crime scene couldn't be from him. The thumbprint found on the lens of the flashlight that was found near the bodies of the girls also didn't match Hart, and the shoe print found in the girls' tent was size 9.5. Hart's would be 11.5. But investigators would argue he had left the same telltale signs on the little girls' bodies that he did on his previous victims. Hart was tried in March of 1979, and although the local sheriff pronounced him 1,000% certain that Hart was guilty, a local jury acquitted him. But he still had 305 years to serve of a 308-year sentence in Oklahoma State Penitentiary. And on June 4th, 1979, just 2 months after the trial, he died of a massive heart attack after about an hour of lifting weights and jogging in the prison exercise yard. He was 35 at the time of his death, and he maintained his innocence of this crime up until the time of his death. After all that, this case was still open and unsolved. Years would go by without any answers, but technology would advance. DNA fingerprinting had been developed in 1987. This test was performed using a sample of Hart's bodily fluids, but the results were inconclusive. In 2002, another test was conducted using a pillowcase from the crime. The samples tested were too deteriorated to yield adequate results. In 2007, a semen sample was tested. Nothing resulted from the sperm sample, but a partial DNA female profile was found. The female DNA could not be ruled out as coming from the victims, but at the time of the murders in 1977, there was talk of a female counselor from England who fled just after the murders. She was never looked into, and nothing ever came of that lead. Now, let's get into the theories of this case. The most common and well-known one is that this wasn't a one-man job. Obviously, by now you know by the information I've given you, people even believe that Hart had nothing to do with this at all. In 1989, Reverend Gerald Manley contacted authorities to say that he thought four men were involved for ending the lives of Farmer, Gousset, and Milner. Manley provided officers with the names of two men that he claimed killed the girls, and while investigators looked into this claim provided by the Reverend, they were unable to link the men to these murders. Manley said he went to Camp Scott with four men whom he claimed needed his Christian influence, and he saw the dead body of one of the girls and two sleeping bags that appeared to contain the corpses of the other two girls. While police have been unable to corroborate the Reverend's story, Manley reportedly passed a lie detector test when questioned about his claims and provided the same account while under hypnosis. Jack Schroff was the owner of a farm only 1 mile west of Camp Scott. His house was searched by police, and they found duct tape and rope that matched the duct tape and rope found at the crime scene. But Schroff claimed his house had been broken into the night before the murders. Other items that were stolen were 3 bottles of beer and 3 identical crowbars. The 3 empty beer bottles would later be found on the campgrounds. Outside Schroff's door, a print was found that matched boot prints near the crime scene. Schroff took a polygraph and passed. He also had a solid alibi the night of the murders. Therefore, he was cleared from being a suspect. There was also some suspicion of dirty police work. When Hart was picked up from the home in Crookston, police did a search of the home and apparently found items the camp counselor claimed had gone missing 2 months prior to the murder. The owner of the house says that those things were never there before police arrived and that they had been planted. And according to the camp counselor, the only thing that had gone missing was donuts. There was also speculation that Sheriff Weaver actually had the photos which allegedly belonged to Hart in his desk at the Mays County Jail and planted them in the cave, therefore tying Hart to the case. The parents of Doris and Lori sued the Magic Empire Girl Scouts for $5 million, alleging that the organization's administrators and the adults in charge were negligent. Parents were never made aware of the threatening note left by presumably the killer 2 months prior to their children's arrival at the camp. They also found that the inadequate supervision of the children and failing to follow up on the sounds Wilhite heard the night of the murders were also issues that ended up being fatal to their daughters' lives. Perhaps if more precautionary measures had been taken, Lori, Doris, and Michelle would still be alive today. After the murders on June 13, 1977, Camp Scott closed its doors for good and was never reopened. The property was eventually sold off to a local family. And to this day, no one really knows what happened on that fatal night in rural Oklahoma. No other suspects were ever determined, and now all samples of DNA taken from the scene are too old for testing, leaving this case unsolved. Next year will be the 43rd anniversary of the death of Doris Milner, Lori Farmer, and Michelle Gousset. This has been the unsolved case of the Oklahoma Girl Scout murders. As always, I'll leave a tip line or the number to Crime Stoppers at the end of this video or in the description box down below. Even though it's probably unlikely that any of you watching this video know anything about this crime, it's still a good precaution. I do encourage that if you are interested, you should do your own research. You never know what you might find that I didn't include in this video. And if I didn't mention anything in this video that you know, leave it in the comments down below for other people to see. I want to thank you for taking the time out of your day to hear these girls' stories. And if you like this video or videos like these, or just true crime in general, subscribe, like, and turn on post notifications because it lets me know that you're enjoying them. I'll be here next Monday with a new case for you. So, stay safe.